to the second part of the presentation this evening. I have our panelists up behind me, and we'll have a short presentation in a second here. I'd like to introduce our panelists to you. First panelist is Mohammad Rashid from the Fox Valley Islamic Society. And our final panel this evening is Heba, Mohammad, a UWGB alumna and former SGA president and president of the Muslim Student Association in the past. All right. I'll turn it over to Mr. Rashid for his short presentation.
Thank you very much. That my wife Roxanne and I ran a business in Green Bay for 15 years. City of Green Bay has treated us very well. City itself, city office, particularly the police department was excellent to work with. As you know, when you run a hotel, your problem every other night, something happens. And the police was very responsive. So we have good memories of Green Bay. Let me start with the common greetings of Muslims that do all over the world. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam.
MashaAllah. You are all used to. Assalamu alaikum means peace be with you. And Muslims all over the world, regardless of their language, greet each other with this salutation. And the response that you just heard, wa alaykum assalam, that says peace be with you as well. That's for Muslims, men, women, both, greet each other. What I was hoping to do, if time allows, quote a couple of verses from Quran, some to summarize for you that Muslims, the religion of Islam is, religion, name of the religion is Islam. Islam word came from the word salam, name, peace through complete submission to God. That's the religion of Islam. The followers of Islam are called Muslims. Muslims take their guidance for two main sources. One is Quran, that Muslims believe, and I believe, the word of God. And the second is the Sunnah or Hadith. That's the sayings and instruction of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I was hoping to quote a couple of verses from Quran, what it says about violence or living in peace, and also quote some hadith, that means the sayings of Prophet. There are a number of them, I don't think I'll have time for all of them, but some I will share with you. Quran, the surah, second surah, verse 143 of Quran, says, we made you to be a community of the middle way, so that the example of your lives, you might bear witness to the truth before all mankind. Another verse says, same surah, to each religious community, we have given a direction which it follows. So compete all together in the performance of good deeds. Whosoever you may be, God shall certainly gather you all for divine judgment. God certainly has power over all things. That's verse 148. Another keep this one. Time is so limited. The other verse I would like to share with you, let there be no compulsion or coercion in the religion. The right direction is distinctly clear from error. Second surah, verse 256. say we believe in God and in what has been revealed to Abraham, Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, and the tribes, and the books given to Moses, Jesus, and the prophets from their Lord. We make no distinction between one and another among them, and to God do we submit in Islam. That's Surah, 3rd Surah, verse 184. Let there arise from among you a band of people who invite to righteousness and enjoin good, forbid evil. That's Quran, Surah, 3rd Surah, verse 104. Then I want to quote some hadith regarding number of things you often hear. So summary I will share with you about jihad and terrorism. From these points you will understand what Islam stands. Learn, teach, and practice Islam in all aspects of one's life. At all times to reach the highest and best education in order to benefit oneself, family, and society. Be a messenger of Islam everywhere, in every behavior and action. Fight evil, wrongdoing, and injustice with all one's power, by one's hand, action, and with one's tongue, speech, or at least with one's heart, prayer. Respond to the call for jihad with money, effort, wisdom, and life, yet never fight a Muslim brother, a Muslim country, or a non-Muslim society that respects the treaties and harbors no aggressive designs against Islam or Muslims. Suicide under any pretext is not condoned as jihad in Islam. Converting people to Islam by force or coercion is never jihad, but a crime punishable by law. Those are some summaries that come from hadith. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says he prohibited Muslims soldiers from killing women, children, and the elderly, or a cut a palm tree, or he advised them, do not betray, do not excessive, do not kill a newborn child. Whoever has killed a person having a treaty with the Muslims shall not smell the fragrance of paradise, though its fragrance is found for a span of 40 years. Distance they're talking about. The first cases to be adjudicated between people on the day of judgment will be those of bloodshed. Killing is the second major sin in Islam. Truly, your blood, your property, and your honor are inviolable. There is a reward for kindness shown to every living animal or human. Those are some of the quotes, and there are many here, so I don't have time. But I wanted to share some historical facts, which is, in addition to what you just heard, Quran and the Hadith or Sunnah, there are thousands and thousands of references of peaceful life, peaceful living. But historical facts are there too. A couple of quick examples. Partly or wholly, Muslims ruled India for 1,000 years. If Muslims would forcibly convert people, you would not see the Hindu population today in India. They're the majority in Indo-Pakistan. In India itself, vast majority is Hindus. 1,000 years Muslims ruled India. Second example would be Spain. 700 years, Muslims ruled Spain. There was no first conversion. That is not the history of Islam. Couple of examples of kindness. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when he got the revelation, he was 13 years in Mecca. After 13 years, when his life became endangered, he had to migrate at the dead of night to Medina, where he was welcomed. People used to know him, know of him. So he went and stayed. When he went to Medina, Meccans could not sleep in peace. They had attacked him time and time again. Every war, he fought it was a defensive war. At the end, he had a pact with them. When his strength became stronger, followers became, number was big, they had signed a pact with Prophet that Muslims would be allowed to, because Mecca was, even before Islam, people used to go for pilgrimage to Mecca. There was a house there. The Muslims believe was built by Prophet Ibrahim. And Muslims would be allowed to do pilgrimage. There are some conditions there. That pact was broken, and then Prophet, peace be upon him, sent a messenger to Meccans. And Meccans said, that pact is null and void. We do not respect that thing. Prophet and his followers said, okay. And then he came to outskirts of Mecca with 10,000 strong army. Meccans were cowardly that he is going to slaughter them all. He surrendered. He allowed non-Muslims, Muslims all to live in peace. Not a single life was lost. After almost 20 years of harassment, war, killing, injustice, that was his response. He did not kill anyone. Second example I will share with you. When the Crusaders went to Middle East, to Jerusalem, they went back and reported to Pope that there's so much people, children, Jews and Muslims were killed, that the blood was flowing up to the knee of their horses. Less than 100 years later, Saladin, Muslim army commander, reconquered Jerusalem. At the end of the war, he did not kill one single life. Historical facts. And Muslims, Christians, Jews were allowed to live in peace. These are historical facts. So the incidents that throughout the world, as unfortunate, I feel all Muslims, Aisha was talking to me, feels guilt by association. But I'd urge you to look beyond it. What are the facts? What is the historical facts that brought us to the point where we are? I would like to have a dialogue with the alderman who made those comments to Heba. I would be interested to have a dialogue with him. In some comments I think I saw, he mentioned that other parts of the country, things like that are happening. I'd like to know which campus, which mosque that he's referring to. There are individual crazes, and these crazes belong to not Islam alone. The crazes belong to all people. But I would urge the politicians throughout the country, Democrats or Republicans, let me share with you. I'm at heart a citizen of America. I love this country because for not anything else but the rule of law, the fairness. Before I came to this country, I craved for it. I lived to live by the rule of law. I love to live by rule of law. That's the best thing that you can offer to the citizens, the fairness and rule of law. I'll share with you that my wife is here. There are times when my children and wife, I would have 5-6 cars in the family. All of them are American cars, primarily GM. Because I loved GM, the largest company in the world. My older son is an attorney in Minneapolis, went to buy a car. And after he bought a car, he called me, Dad, I was thinking of you. I bought a Ford. I am at heart a citizen of America. I want good for America. So what I think, I tell my Muslim brothers, that I do not hesitate to criticize American government policy. I'm not criticizing America. I have every right to criticize the government policy. So to the politicians, I say, if I'm a father, how I behave, how I talk, I have a responsibility to my children, because the children take cue from me. If you are a teacher, the students look up to you. How you talk, how you behave, they take cue from you. When you're a politician, the citizens take cue from you. 2-3 years back, you have all heard, is a gentleman, his reason was, he went to Sikh temple in Milwaukee and shot and killed a number of innocent people. There are people, those who are on the edge throughout the society, as you know. They don't think for themselves. They take cue from the leaders. The leaders, in the interest of getting vote, they just think they, you know, somebody's told today, the alderman has the right to say what he wants to say. Of course, you do. But you have to think that you, what you say, has a consequence. There are people who look up to you, take cues from you. Those people, those who don't think for themselves, will act. When they act, things happen like Sikh temple. Isn't that a sad thing? The fear-mongering, the politics of fear-mongering, you all must have seen, I have seen, it saddened me that a lady from Africa went to school to pick up her daughter. And then another lady, white lady, to pick up her daughter. As they were in the parking lot, the white lady mother became angry at the African lady. She is not from Africa, but maybe her generation came from Africa. These are the bitches that brought Ebola to America. And I am not thinking about the African mother. I'm thinking of these two children. What are they learning from this mother? Her own child and the child of the other mother. But these are the bitches brought Ebola to America. And you are in a country most advanced in the world. So as a citizen, what you are doing tonight, I appreciate it. Wish that's all we can do. I'll tell you, I'm not afraid of my life. If telling the truth cost my life, so be it. I'll continue to talk. Islam is the religion of peace. There are more than 1.7 billion Muslims throughout the world. How many people are involved, whatever conflicts are going on throughout the world? Even with the history of those conflicts, I gave a talk years ago. These are bushfires. The colonial history left these bushfires. They will continue to burn up to the end of time. You know why? Because the big powers could not solve them. They're biased people. You want to impose a resolution on the weaker people. The weaker people, when they get a strength, it will burn again. It will not be solved. If you don't solve the conflict based on fairness, the conflict is not resolved. The weaker party will keep it in mind, will be hurt, and someday when they get the opportunity, they will be turned. I would like to ask the alderman. He has every right to say if the MSA is supporting Hamas. Fair. That's the American policy, fair. But does he also not see the American policy for the last few administrations, the two-state policy? When the Israel built those settlements in Jerusalem, destroying any chance of peace, is he going to speak up? I don't hear that. That's the American policy too. But I don't hear that. If you are to solve conflicts, you have to solve it based on fairness. Otherwise, these bushfires will continue to burn, and will burn with it. What is fear-mongering? Ebola? Just ban all these African countries to fly in and out of America. That's the solution. A few years back, Japan had a tsunami. You know, before the tsunami, they had built a big, tall wall there. But the tsunami was so powerful, water came over the wall. But the wall was the cause of thousands of deaths. Because once water came in, water was not able to go out. Wall kept them in, kept the water in. And people died. So human solution, I'm not saying the wall was the wrong thing to do. We have to think through that unless we are fair, if we do injustice to people, there will be repercussions. Because God is just. God is just. He is more, much more patient than we are. But he will take his time and punish those people, those who are unjust. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Mohammad. That's really, thank you. Heba and I are here to talk about the Muslim Student Association, and actually we have a couple of PowerPoint slides, and I was wondering if somebody could open them up for us? And we don't have a lot, but, and we won't talk very long. So Professor Curry and I are co-advisors for the MSA, and Heba was the founder of the organization, or the association, 4 years ago. And want to say that the last, in reading all the comments, the negative comments about the MSA being, I don't know, supporter of radical Islamic ideology and terrorism, were really, really hurtful. Because they're also very wrong. And we're here to address that and to talk a bit about what the MSA does and really the kinds of things that we have, well, the students, I keep saying we, but the students have done to promote education and awareness and friendship. So first, maybe I'll pass the mic over to Heba, and she could talk a bit about the organization.
Okay, thank you. I'll be brief. So originally, the idea to found the Muslim Students Association wasn't even mine. It was an idea given to me by somebody else who thought that the UW-Green Bay campus needed an organization like that to educate students about Islam. And this came at a time when we were getting a number of international students who identified as Muslim. And so we had a growing population on campus, and so it was a great opportunity and I think good timing to do that. And so when we founded it, the original purpose was not only to educate about Islam to non-Muslims, but to also build a stronger connection between the Muslim students on campus and give them a sense of community here where sometimes you might not necessarily feel that if you don't know someone who identifies the same way as you. And so of all the programs that we've done Islam Awareness Weeks and done programs over an Islam Awareness Month. I think it was once a week, but we try and do something generally once a semester, have a group of programs to do. They've always been very successful. I think people are genuinely interested in Islam and also in dispelling myths about Islam. We had tried to cover topics, women in Islam, which is typically a very contentious topic, and other topics as well that were suggested to us a lot of the times. So that's a basic background about MSA, and I see that Gemma's flipping through some slides, which is wonderful.
I don't have the remaining.
I'll just give you some examples of the types of things that the students have organized. As Heba mentioned, we have flyers, F2, from, we've had Islam Awareness
well, week, and actually it often ends up being a month of activities, but 3 years now. And it's a tremendous amount of work for the students, and but it's really worth it. Actually, it's a week where we have people come and hear talks, lectures by local professors, students watch movies, and we'll talk about, sometimes local women will come and talk about Islam and or veiling. These are the types of things that the Student Association does. And the membership of the Student Association has always been small. It's been about, I think, 6-7 students. And these are Muslim students and non-Muslim students. But when we're planning our association, the Islam Awareness Week, we have a lot of students who come to help us, and also faculty, and of course lots of staff too. Actually, a lot of the students who are here serving are also very supportive of the MSA. It's never been a political group. That's not the intention. And actually, Gemma, if you go back to one of the slides, this one, if anybody has any questions, they can go to the student services website, and they can find the MSA's MSA's mission. And this has been the mission for several years. And I just note, to make friends is part of the mission. So the misperception of what the MSA does is very unfortunate. And we're hoping that people will come to the students and ask questions and learn about Islam and create discussions and dialogues. And anyway.
So last comment from me. I think one of my favorite things that I have experienced when I was still a student here and working with MSA is really getting to know the Muslim community more. So I lived on campus, didn't really have an opportunity to get to know anyone outside of campus, and I really have to give credit to the Mauthe Center and Aisha back there for really bringing in Muslims from this community and other communities as well to support the MSA programs and their missions. This isn't Mohammed's first time helping us. We've had Roxana help us before, and several people come in and join us. So just having that show of solidarity from Muslims from several different communities has been wonderful. And the Mauthe Center has been wonderful as well in always supporting us and helping us with that. So I just wanted to thank them.
And also, actually, this is the biggest turnout we've had for any of our events, so maybe the controversy has actually paying off for us. Yes. But anyway, and by the way, we will have another Islam Awareness Week and next year, and it's always in April, and we invite you and to come and tell your friends and people in the community to please attend, because it's always a lot of fun, and we try to have food every night. So if you like this food, it just kind of gives you an idea of what we provide. Okay, thank you.
We have a couple of questions here, maybe that I'll start, that people wrote down, and then if anyone has questions that they'd like to ask and raise their hand, we can do that as well. The first one, which I think fits in with both of the presentations you gave, as well as the impetus for tonight, was someone asked, how do you start a dialogue about religion, tolerance, prejudice, etc., with a complete stranger in a respectful way? So how, obviously there was a communication problem, issue that led up to some of this, but what are some things about how can we go about approaching a dialogue when people do have questions about these things?
Yes,
please.
Frankly speaking, anytime there is an interest to come and talk about Islam, religion, and activities, we are not offended. We always welcome the opportunity to come and talk. So if somebody is genuinely interested to learn more about Islam or some of the conflicts, for example, somebody wants to talk about, I am, or our community is always happy to come and talk and do the dialogue. There is nothing offensive about wanting to know more and have a dialogue. We always welcome that.
Another question, what are some of the experiences that the media doesn't cover with regard to Muslims or Islam?
That's an interesting topic. Those number of articles over the years that I've seen, as you probably know, they quote a verse, not the context, or before or after a verse. Oftentimes, very misleading way, and with a good agenda behind it. Almost always I see that. Very rare do I see a sincere attempt to educate people. Most of the time, these are agenda-based writings, and which creates more confusion and misunderstanding.
And I'll just add to that. I think a lot of times, too, they ignore the diversity within people who practice Islam. So, you know, we see a lot of, you know, terrorism highlighted in different terrorist groups, but you know, not all Muslims are Arab. Not all Arabs are Muslim either, and I think that's one of the facts on your sheet. But there are large Muslim populations outside of the Middle East, and so I think a lot of times that's ignored to a fault, actually.
If I could add to that, to be honest with you, only 20% of Muslim population live in the Middle East. 80% of Muslims live outside the Middle East.
Are there questions that people have that you might like to ask? We have others that we can ask from those written down, but if someone would like to ask a question based on the presentations, please. Yeah.
I just have the question is, I guess, you know, I was kind of a little...
I guess I was kind of out of the loop. You know, I read that Alderman, that Wery's comment, but I didn't get the context of that either, and maybe you could explain this more to me. Did he say something like he thought that the Mauthe Center here was trying to do terrorist acts and stuff like this? Really?
The questions that he had was about what the purpose of the Muslim student organization was, and whether it's condemned terrorism and Hamas specifically. So that he thought or had heard that there had been other Muslim student organizations around the country that for where there had been problems, and wanted to know specifically about the one here and whether it condemned. Exactly. Other questions?
I think to that point, another part that was said in, another part of that question that Alderman Wery asked regarded Sharia law. So I would like to maybe have a little clarification on that in terms of what it might mean.
I did not see what his comment regarding Sharia law was. Sharia is a code of conduct, that how there's a prescription how we should live our life for Muslims. And that's a vast chapter, vast volume of Sharia law. And I do not know what the concern there is. In America, there is a process how to change law. To change the constitution, it takes 2/3 of the state legislature to pass that law. Equal rights could not be passed. It took years and years and years, it didn't get passed. So just because there are a growing number of Muslims coming here doesn't make it, they will become a Sharia law. Throughout the world, there are more than 60 countries that has Muslim majority. The only one country that I know of implement Sharia law is Saudi Arabia. None of the Muslim countries implement Sharia law. So I really think that it's taking totally out of proportion saying that Sharia law is coming to America. If people doesn't know how constitution gets amended in America, should not have any concern.
Thank you.
It's up to people, what I'm trying to say. It will be up to people.
Thank you. You mentioned the great diversity of Muslims in the world, and I'm wondering, in Green Bay, is there a great deal of diversity, and how's everyone getting along?
Well, I've only been here for, 4 years now, but it's my understanding that there's a growing Somali population in Green Bay, which is wonderful, and I think that's adding a lot of diversity and a lot of culture to our community. And from my understanding, most Muslims get along. I've never heard of a controversy between Muslims in the community. I mean, maybe Mohammad can speak to it more, but I think the nice thing too is that, not only Green Bay, but Milwaukee and some other bigger cities have Muslim populations, and I think there has been some cross-collaboration between organizations and even just people. So I'm from the Milwaukee area, and now I'm here, and so that opens up doors to have those conversations between different mosques and even just different organizations. And so, I've had a pretty positive experience with other Muslims in the community, and I'm sure that will continue.
So. Hi, I'm Tony. I came from Jordan. I'm Jordanian, Arab. I was a missionary Christian in Jordan. I just want to comment on how beautiful Islam is. People always, as Heba said, not all Arabs are Muslims and not all Muslims are Arab. Indonesia alone is, the population there with the majority of the people is all Muslims. There alone covers the Middle East. My comment is, I've lived 27 years in Jordan. It's a Muslim country. We never have a problem. We're all one hand. We go out together, we come back. My best friend, actually, me and him, we wrote the first Arabic spoken dictionary and the first Arabic culture book from the Arab perspective. That's where we met Dr. Heidi and Heba when they came and bought our books and we became friends. My point is, Islam is not a terrorist religion. It's not a hatred religion. It's not a religion to beat down their wives or kids or abuse everything that we see on TV. The main point is here, media. That's how I see it. Media, what we have, what we're drinking from the TV is because we became slaves for that TV. And same thing back home, I'm not saying anything good about our media. What we know about, it's nothing good about our media either. Because what we know about America is from Hollywood. Beowulf and these weird stuff that we watch. But same thing here. They focus on less than 1%. Imagine that, less than 1% on the Arabic nation. ISIS. Does the media show that all the Arab nations are fighting ISIS? No. But that's what's the evil, is the media. Christians and Muslims live one hand, and we're all brothers and sisters. Again, my business partner is named Ahmed, and we are best friends since 1998. We are one family. He's Muslim, and I'm Christian.
I wanted to know, this is a little bit related to what I wrote on a piece of paper, but you can throw my paper away and I'll just ask it now. I wanted to know if it's possible to have interfaith marriages, and I'm not talking necessarily between like a Muslim and a Jew or Muslim and Christian, because they still all follow the same line, the Bible and everything, but I'm talking about like with a Buddhist or a Hindu or with, or even a non-deist completely. Is that possible, and will the family, the family accept it?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer your question. Every time the question is asked of religion, I'll be very honest with you. As a Muslim, no Muslim, even I'm not a scholar, I'm a layman, will be able to say what is politically right. We will tell you what Islam says. That means only Abrahamic religions, the Jews and the Christians, that intermarriage is allowed, and there is restriction there too. If a Muslim boy can marry a Christian girl, a Jewish girl, but we prefer the Jewish girl, the wife become a Muslim, for the sake of the family and the children. But a Muslim girl cannot marry a Christian boy or a Jew, even a Jewish boy, if they remain a Jew and a Christian. They will have to accept Islam to marry a Muslim girl. Again, the logic behind is the future of the children, that children cannot, which way the children will go, with the father or the mother. To avoid that, that Islam says a Muslim girl would not be able to marry any non-Muslim young man. So that's the answer. And about the other religion of the same, they will have to come into Islam to marry a Muslim boy or a Muslim girl. It's Hinduism, Hindu, Buddhist, or any other religious people.
Other questions? Another question that was written down has to do with the daily prayers. If you could say something about the daily prayer ritual for Muslims.
The Muslims, we did not talk about today the religious practices because that was not the topic. But I'm happy to tell you, the Muslims are required obligatory prayer 5 times a day. The first prayer is the first thing before the sunrise. We have a prayer in the morning. Then we have a prayer midday. And then we have a prayer mid-afternoon. Then another prayer right after sunset. And another prayer hour and a half after that before you go to bed. The 5 times prayer, daily prayer, obligatory for Muslims. And all Muslims, these are obligatory, there is no excuse. No matter where you are to pray. That's the requirement. Now, if for some reason you're a doctor, you're getting into a surgery, you can combine some prayers so that you can do your job and still pray. So there are ways to manage the prayer, but you have still have to pray.
So the incident last week that we saw was pretty played out in social media, but what kind of other situations aren't we seeing that are along those lines that maybe the public aren't aware of?
Discrimination.
Yes, yeah, discrimination.
Frankly speaking, my wife and I would say that we've been very fortunate. It's a blessing that we have a lot of good friends throughout Fox Cities, including Green Bay. We haven't run into any situation that would be discriminatory or offensive to us. But there are other friends, other people that experienced discrimination or some kind of something, the people would comment and so on. We have been really. One incident I would share with you. Maybe I will not get this story right. My second son was going to Appleton East. And when he was a junior, I think, he had written something in his hand.
Invincible,
okay. Something like that he wrote in his with a marker or something. And the teacher saw that in an art class or something.
Right after 9/11, the day after 9/11, and Michael Jackson's CD came out, Invincible. That's what he loved, Michael.
So anyways, he was called into principal's office, and there were assistant principal, 3 other people interviewed him. He came home very emotional, very upset, and both my wife and I, we tried to calm him down. Later on, for another reason, I went to see the principal, and I forgot about the incident. I'm not a vengeant type of person. At the moment, I didn't like it. I was going to talk to the principal, but when I went to see the principal, talked about other things, I forgot all about this. I did not bring it up, but my son was pretty upset about that. But then again, we are all human. No harm was done to him other than he was a young boy. It was emotionally distressed to him too. But they, instead of three people, principal and everybody, interviewing him, the teacher would have asked him, what do you mean by invincible? He probably would have explained to her. Instead, she made it a big deal, and he was called into office and so on. But again, let me share, so if there is any concern or fear, let me tell you this. I am a Muslim. My parents were Muslim, came from Bangladesh, both of us, my wife and I. The religion that I know, the religion that I practice, the principles that were taught to us, I find my religion tell you even not to offend somebody with my words. It is that careful not to be even offensive to another person. That is the religion of Islam. If somebody follows the teachings of Islam, they cannot be offensive to other people with their words, with their tongue. That's the religion of Islam. For the since September 11, we have gone through a lot. FBI continuously keeps in touch with us, and I don't mind them. The FBI agent from Green Bay met with me, because I'm the president of the society, a number of times. The last time I met with him, I told him, the one thing I can assure you, if I know of any plans to harm somebody, my God tells me either I have to stop it or find ways to stop it. I will be the first one. I know all of my community members that I know, each one of them would go to you or the police in the first hint of it. If we know somebody is planning to hurt somebody, I promise you, I'll be the first one to report that. Because regardless of who he is, if he's going to harm somebody, it is my obligation to stop. And that would be vast majority of the Muslims, if they are Muslims. That's their obligation. So if anything I could live with is this assurance.
Thank you very much.
I think it has something.
Can I just jump in really quickly? Okay, so to your question, I think more and more, thanks to social media, that's where a lot of this type of stuff happens. It's so easy to just pull something behind your computer and never have to meet someone face to face. So I would encourage all of you, there's data to back up that when you get to know somebody of a different background, you start to understand them more and their culture and their population more. And so if you have a question about any culture, I would highly recommend that you get to know somebody, because that's the best way to dispel any stereotypes, to also learn about the variations within those cultures. That's the best way to do it. And I would also say be aware of systematic stereotypes and racism. When I was entering middle school, I got transferred to a suburban school, and they instantly enrolled me in ESL. I was born and raised here. English is my primary language. And I've never seen my mother so upset about something than them, systemizing me and just throwing me in based on my last name. So I think being aware of that and getting to know people and just opening up those dialogues and not being afraid. If someone's a stranger, introduce yourself and don't be strangers anymore.
There's one other thing I wanted to mention. I have a friend who's Muslim and in Green Bay, and she and her family actually had to move because the neighbors were afraid of them and called them terrorists. And it was too painful for the Muslim family to stay, to be constantly under suspicion. And the family accusing them had no interest in getting to know them. So things like this do happen, and you're right, they don't get covered in the news.
I just want to share with you quickly that when we built our mosque in Nina, that was 1980, a small mosque, and we went to the town of Nina board for approval. All the neighbors came to the meeting opposing the building of the mosque in their neighborhood. Press Gazette, Post Crescent, and Northwestern. I'm not sure of Press Gazette. Post Crescent and Northwestern wrote editorial to support the building of the mosque. What I'm sharing this story is the neighbors, those who opposed us so much, over the years, they are all our friends now. One of the neighbors just immediately close to the mosque for the last 30 years took care of the lawn, watched over the building, became our good friends. Just last month, he passed away. We visited his wife. It was very sad to see a friend go. And they all became very good friends. So at that point, I think what happened there, they've never heard of Islam. They thought it was some sort of cult or something coming. And over the time, they found out that they're real human beings and peaceful people. So they became our friends.
Thank you very much. I want to give a hand for our panel. I know there are a lot of other questions out there, both on paper and probably in your minds. I'm hoping that your panelists will be open to one-on-one questions after our program, but I do want to let our last presenters do give their presentation before we let you go for the evening. So if I could have our last presenters come up, and while you get ready, if you need to stand and stretch or something like that, we'll have that up in just a second. Quinn Merriweather from Office of Residence Life, and Lindsay Johnson from UW Green Bay Public Safety.
Hi. We'll make this really short. But over the summer, Christy and I, along with 20 other individuals, got the chance to participate in a three-day training about Stop the Hate, talking specifically about hate crimes and bias incidents and what we can do to be proactive to combat these kind of actions on our college campus. So we just want to start off by just giving you some basic information about what a bias incident report is. So by definition, a hate incident is an act of conduct, speech, or expression to which a biased motive is evident as a contributing factor, regardless of whether a criminal act is committed. A hate crime is an incident that has risen to the level of a crime, so a criminal act. All hate crimes are biased incidents, but not all biased incidents are hate crimes. That's the most important information we want to give to you, so you understand that. Defining a hate crime. That's really small. Okay. That's not how it looked on the computer. A hate crime is a crime committed in whole or in part because of the victim's actual or perceived race, gender, nationality, ethnicity, sexual orientation, disability, or religion. States vary on which groups are included in their laws, so it's important to know if you are within that umbrella, depending on the state that you live in. Five states have no hate crime law. Federal hate crime law includes only crimes of physical violence. So there are some differences. But you know, again, if we're proactive on our college campuses, if we're proactive in our communities, we can combat this. Overall, the goal of crime law and other bias prevention efforts is to prevent criminal behavior motivated by bias. So again, just being proactive.
So what we did on campus, because of the Stop the Hate training we did, everyone kind of wanted to collaboratively figure out an idea of how we can report this on campus and how public safety can become aware of it. Also, Gina's students, everyone who needs to become aware, how they can become aware. They made it very user-friendly, so they made an online incident report that you can go on and fill out. They should be able to click, but anyway, it's available on multiple websites. The AIC, DOS, and IE websites, they made it very available to students to be able to find it on campus and to be able to report hate crime or any bias incidents that they see on campus. The goals of it are obviously for,
I think the internet connection is not connected
to it, okay.
So, it's not
so pretty much what it is it's for for public safety, dean of students, everyone who needs to become aware, for them to be able to come aware, whether or not people want action taken, or just for them to be known about what's going on campus. Also, if they do want action taken, it's a way that we can take action. Whether or not it just has to involve dean of students, has to go further, and if dean of students feels it's applicable to public safety, we will, you know, we'll be there in any way, shape, or form we can. We respond to whatever we can, and we take everything very seriously, you know, no matter how big, small it is. We investigate whatever we can, we talk to whoever we have to talk to, and then we go above and beyond and we talk to other areas on campus and other offices, other departments to get whoever involved we need to get involved to just kibosh it all together or address it in any way we have to. The bias incident form, it was coordinated by the Dean of Students Office, and then, like I said, public safety is called if needed. If Dean of Students wants to handle it themselves or they can handle it internally, they do. If it does need to go you know, higher up, we'll handle it as well. We're always there as a resource. And then, like I said, we take other offices and other employees and anyone else we need help or whoever else needs to be aware of it, whether it's housing or teachers, if it's any other department on campus, we make sure they're aware of it as well. So as many people know about it as they need to.
Absolutely. So really, really what it comes down to it is that any kind of training that we offer our students, whether they're RAs, student leaders, workers in the union, at the press, we show them this report. We tell them that even if you don't have all the information, it's just best to put all that you can. And then from there, the people that do get it, public safety, the dean of students, they can then take action, follow if need be, provide that support to that student who is reporting, and to let them know of the options that they have to their, or that they have at their disposal. But ultimately, this is a very condensed version of our three-day training, but as always, there are countless people on this campus that have this information. We have a few actually in this room, student leaders, professionals. So if ever you have a question, please do not feel hesitant to ask. And thank you, or unless there's any questions.
We have a state law against hate crime, right?
Yep, there's state hate crime laws, but handling it on campus. Yes. So handling it on campus, though, we go through this. Some people want to report either anonymously or just a way to get it triggered. I mean, some people don't like coming straight to public safety. They don't feel comfortable meeting in an office with, you know, an AC or, you know, someone higher on campus. So it's a slower way for them to do it. I mean, just to get it out there and get it knowledgeable. But yes, there are Wisconsin hate crime laws, and that's what we will follow once we figure out if it is one and how it's categorized and go from there.
And it's all inclusive. It's not, it doesn't have things that aren't in, like you were saying before, that certain states have like limited bias. And this is like, do you cover everything or you don't, or you don't?
Verbiage-wise, I can't recite it for you, so I can't tell you all what it includes, but I mean, obviously every incident, we have to pick apart everything that's with it and see if it fits into the statute altogether.
And so know that the colleges shift in this thinking. They have a lot of practices in place to be preventative and to be proactive in that regard, but it may be a college in a state that doesn't have that umbrella, but know that this is something that we do want to combat and deal with as it happens.
Okay. Thank you very much. All right, well, thank you very much for staying with us this evening and listening to all of our presenters. I did hear someone asking about donations. There is a basket over there for the Mauthe Center if you're interested, but a big thank you to our three panelists tonight, through all the campus departments who participated in this, to the Mauthe Center especially for hosting us in this room. There are some yellow sheets on your table with more resources and information. I encourage you to stay and continue your conversations, ask your questions of your panelists who are still here. And did you want anything else?
I just wanted to thank the three deans, Sue Madison, Scott Furlong, and Brenda Amundson Hill for their support in this program and helping to get it off the ground. So thank you. Oh, very much.
I think, Ben, there is some leftover rice if anyone's interested. Otherwise, have a
doing that.